Hello, fellow Marks. I'm Pruitt, and this is Jim Davis. You ever have those people that just never tell you the truth, are just devious and deceitful, and just silver-tongued devils that just, like, anyway, we're going to do a show today on, layers! This episode has been brought to you by Deck of Many. They make reference cards for all of your 5th edition Dungeons & Dragons games, with all the info you need for your games to run smoothly right at your fingertips.
They've got decks for weapons, conditions, NPCs, monsters. They've even got a deck of many things, as well as blank cards for your homebrew content in every deck. They've got a Black Friday sale through the end of November 2018. Use the code WebDM5 for an extra 5% off your order.
Check them out at deckofmany.com, links in the description. And if you're gonna be at PAX Unplugged, go see them in person. We know we will. Here we are. We're in Hogfly Studios. WebDM's lair.
Yes.
Basically.
Yeah, right.
Right?
Yeah,
right? We've already done our lair action of the intro. Let's talk about what it takes to make a lair for
right.
for the DMs out there that they have their badass group of goblins or their dragon or their whatever, and they want to like make that perfect lair. So yeah. First off, let's just kind of like break down like what's the difference between a lair and just a place where you hang your hat.
Like a lair is not just a place that you fight the bad guy,
right?
It's not just a place for combat and a place for confrontation. It is a resource for your villains and antagonist groups. It's a place that you can show off their sort of personality, tell part of the sort of backstory that you might have worked up for them. It's a place for the party to learn things about their antagonists, whether they've defeated them or are escaping in defeat themselves. Mm-hmm. It's all of those things sort of rolled up into one. But if you're a new dungeon master or you're not really doing, you know, used to doing your own homebrew and you're just sort of venturing out into that, you might go looking in the official materials for sort of advice or guidance on crafting lairs. And I think the Monster Manual it's like just a tiny little section on layers and what they mean. And
it's like three paragraphs.
Right.
And they're like two sentence paragraphs.
Right. It's really not a lot. It basically explains how layer actions work and sort of how regional effects work, which are fifth edition's way of making the layer an element of play.
Yeah.
More than just the side of an adventure. They're sort of making it a character in and of itself. And sometimes it's really appropriate, right? Like there's a lot of environments that you might have an adventure in that are character in and of themselves. The Underdark, for instance, is twisting tunnels and cavernous spaces and an all-encroaching darkness that's constantly eating away at your light source. And the whole place inspires isolation and madness and confusion, and it's an mm-hmm. alien environment.
And it's teeming with things that can see in that dark
that can
and
see
they want to kill you.
Right. And so, like, you really owe it to your players and to your world that you're creating to bring that to life, and giving some thought to your villains' lairs will help with that. So first off, really more than anything, the lair actions in 5th edition are pretty standard, right? It's mm-hmm. usually they go on initiative count 20, they lose any ties to initiative, you can't use the same option twice in a row. Those lair actions, I see them as, they're a way to show how the environment complements or compensates for some weakness in the monster that you've got or the villain that you've got, right? It's your chance to have the a magical effect. You know, one of the reasons maybe why they chose the lair to give them a buff or potentially hinder the party in some way or some sort of environmental effect that might be a characteristic of where they're at. A volcano with lava, for instance, or
so you have like fire gouts that shoot out every now and again.
Sure. Or sulfurous poisonous gases and rock slides and sort of like maybe a tunnel that has a layer of crust on it that looks like it's fine and mm-hmm. is that sort of sticky gelatinous very muddy kind of lava. Of course, all of it's cartoon fantasy lava, not actual real lava, because then they would never be able to go in the volcano in the first place.
Well,
right, so
not splitting hairs,
right?
Here,
right,
but making
maybe,
layers.
Maybe you want, maybe you do want to do that. We are making layers. Those are sort of some of the things that you want to think about when you're designing your lair actions, or even if you're just taking one of the monsters in the monster manual and kind of looking at how the lair actions highlight the monster or feature some part of it. Consider how you would describe those things and sort of go from there. One that I don't see used in the Monster Manual is having minions be the agents of the lair,
action,
right?
Yeah.
So it's like, you know, your big ogre king or whatever has a bunch of little goblins running around. Maybe the lair action is the goblins handing them a potion or a...
Or a volley of arrows.
Or a volley of arrows of some kind. You can simulate the effect of having, like, say, a large horde of minions... Not just through having them, you know, have you know, their own initiative order, but if you don't want to have to deal with, say, you know, 100 goblins or something, then you can have sort of abstract that through lair actions and the like, or maybe it's like a lich with you know, a cabal of apprentices or something, and the lair actions are them channeling magic into the lich, or group casting a spell of some kind that that hinders the party or something.
Maybe the lair action could be the minions hold concentration on a lich's spell, so that. When he casts a spell, the lair action is they take the concentration for that, then he casts another concentration, something like that.
Yeah, that's really cool for that. Yeah, you could. There's a ton of things you can do, and the lair actions, because it's not confined to the normal sort of like, what can a monster do, what can't they do, there's a lot of ways that you can get around some of the limitations of the rules if you've got players who are like on it and just be like, why are you doing this? That's not in the rules. Like, how'd you... You know, everybody has run into those players before who want you to justify what you're doing.
It's like, I'm the DM, I'll do what the fuck I want.
Right, it's a lair action, it's whatever I want it to happen. So, yeah. But yeah, you're right, like, swapping concentration, you know, having them, you know, heal up or something. I think the Aboleth maybe has a lair action that lets it drain the hit points from one of its...
Yeah, anybody who's thralled, mm-hmm. it can suck the hit points out.
Yeah, so lair actions that complement the monster either by, say, you know, big bruiser, right? Ogremok is one of the elemental princes, and it's a big sort of like, you know, get into melee with it and it just busts you up. And so a lot of its lair actions are about restraining or knocking down or hindering the movement of, making it more difficult for the party to get away or stay at range. And so you can either have lair actions that do that or lair actions that, you know, shore up some kind of weakness or something that the monster has. Mm-hmm. If it doesn't do a lot of damage, maybe there's a lair action that does a lot of damage as like a rock slide or a magical glyph goes off or something like that.
Yeah.
So that's sort of things that you want to think about when you're designing your lair actions. Just keep those in mind.
Okay. Well, let's move on to regional effects.
Yeah.
And like, you know, how that lair impacts the surrounding area. Like
right.
Different ways to think about that.
I think regional effects is probably one of my favorite things about mm-hmm. the legendary monster and sort of the things that they've added in to the 5th edition Monster Manual, because it bridges that gap between the high concept world building that a lot of dungeon masters really like to do, and sort of how does my world fit together? What are the societies in it like? How have they all grown up and developed, and what have they left behind? All that. And the regional effects are, you know, you pick your monsters. It requires you to think ahead a bit, particularly if you like designing sandbox style locations or something like that. Picking your big monsters ahead of time, so that you can look and see, all right, what really happens when a dragon makes its lair nearby? How can I describe the environment around it? How is it different than neighboring regions or something like that? You can highlight both sort of what's unique about your setting, particularly if you're using a lot of custom monsters with a lot of custom lair actions and regional effects and the like. But you can also preview and showcase and foreshadow what's in store for the party later on. Yeah. So an example of this would be, I have Land Between Two Rivers is my gonzo post-apocalyptic science fantasy setting that we play on Twitch. And party is traveling through a petrified forest at the behest of a powerful Medusa to go and eliminate a rival. And the petrified forest is a consequence of a nearby earth elemental portal. And they're fighting a creature that has chosen to like open a rift into water in this earth region. And so there's lots of ooze and mud and everything. And so I describe, like, as they get closer to this rival's lair, the dry gullies that they were going through are now bubbling with mud and sort of mineral springs that appear to be just oozing all over the place, and there's noxious fumes everywhere, and they descend into a crack in the earth, and it's slime and mold and mm-hmm. gross fungi growing everywhere, and it's taken over one of the inhabitants and sucked its brain out and inserted its oozy psychic, you know, will over the the original inhabitant. And it's different than just saying like, okay, you get to the dungeon and there it is, and you know, you fight the ooze sorcerer and
you find a portal to the plane of water.
Right, or you find a they find a portal to the plane of water. and did some exploring there. On the map, it's a distinct looking hex, right? Like, I know that within 6 miles of this cave, ooze naturally forms. The ground becomes muddy without there being any water nearby. The whole place has a wet, muddy, humid sort of feel to it. And that's one way to kind of foreshadow if the party's paying attention, if they're seeing the differences between where they were coming from and where they're going, they can start to learn about the enemy that they face. Same with the dragons, same with all the different kinds of creatures that have regional effects. You can foreshadow, you can hint, you can suggest that there is greater danger nearby. And that also ties into the world building that you're doing with the monsters, right? Mm-hmm. Like, if you've got two monsters that have regional effects in close proximity to each other, then what's that do to the locals, right? Like, how do they react to, say, living in this monster's sphere of influence, right?
Well, I mean, you know, do they cower in fear all day? Do they show difference? Do they show, like, loyalty and offer it tribute? Do they offer it tribute out of fear? They're like, oh, we got to get the harvest. And it's like, well, there's only like 30 of y'all. It's like, no. We got to get the harvest ready. Yeah. You know?
Right.
He'll be here soon. Yeah. You know? That kind of stuff.
This is one of the reasons that I really like Dungeons & Dragons, is that they have a strong elemental feel to them, and the effects that they have on their environment are one of those things that I start with the regional effects in the Monster Manual. And then if I need them to be greater than they are to represent, like, you know, this dragon has grown in power and its area, its sphere of influence, the area that its mere presence warps to conform to the dragon, right? It's like that, it's like that,
like Godzilla.
That Godzilla anime we were watching where the environment mimics and molds itself and changes to adapt to this apex predator that's in the region and make itself more inviting for the creature to stay, then you can world build with that. There's legends surrounding those locations and the like. So, and then the final thing with all this is just use your encounter tables to hint at what's ahead. If you're really wanting to highlight the power of a big monster in your region, then select the second biggest monster and have the party find its carcass, right? Like, have the party come across a massive just manticore that's been savaged by something bigger than itself, or you know, the carcass of a giant that's just been scorched and incinerated and reduced to cinders. And that's one way to sort of show the party, like, we are in territory where there are monsters, they're big and bad, and we should be careful. So you can do those things by using the regional effects and the like. Of course, sometimes they influence the monster in their lair.
You got your regional effects
for
your lair. What are some of the different kinds of locations that you can put your lair to show off those regional effects?
You can sort of think of the monster's lair as in two parts, right? Mm-hmm. There is the lair itself, which we'll get to some specific examples here in a bit. But then the larger environment that it's a part of oftentimes colors what the lair is like, right? So we'll give you an example. Take an aboleth. Aboleths, like, you know, aquatic environments and the like, and an aboleth that lives in a swamp versus the bottom of an ocean trench versus the flooded sewer tunnels of an ancient city.
Or just a lock,
right? A lake that's been, you know, cut off and isolated. All of those things make the monster that's there different because its access to resources is different, its access to minions, type of resource, is different, and its ability to influence the world around it is going to be different. The aboleth that makes its home at the bottom of an ocean trench might not care at all what goes on in the kingdom of whatever Donia that you've cooked up. But the one that lives underneath the capital in the old reservoir might be a bit more involved in the comings and goings of the court and the
like. Yeah, I mean, it probably has the king or the baron or whoever, the duke. Might be a kick-ass duke,
right?
He still works at the behest of the aboleth that lives down underneath the old tower.
Right.
You know?
Exactly.
A little clammy.
Yes, just a little clammy, a little phlegmy.
Yeah.
You know? The Monster Manual has a really great... The front portion of the Monster Manual is worth a reread, particularly if you're a dungeon master who's been DMing for a while. It's sometimes nice to go back and reread the basics. And the Monster Manual has a really great breakdown of the different types of environments that you might encounter creatures in. And they list them as dungeons, the Underdark, wilderness, which encompasses all manner of stuff, urban environments, underwater, and of course, planar locations. And if we just consider another creature like a dragon, you know, if we run down that list and take the same dragon in each one of those locations, it's going to be a different type of encounter, a different type of monster. Sometimes it might be like an absolute antagonist, right?
Yeah.
Like, you know, you encounter a dragon in the Underdark, then it's probably bad news, and it's going to be a fight to the finish from this thing. But an urban dragon, a dragon that's disguised itself and has insinuated itself into mortal society, not in a city like Waterdeep, of course. They're smart enough to keep dragons out of there, but other cities might not be so fortunate, and so you might
but have beholders,
but beholders, right? You might have scheming dragons that masquerade as nobles, or maybe the nobility are all dragons, yeah. Right? And that's just the deal with the nobles, is that they're all polymorphed or dragons. And so think about where, not just the lair itself and what's inside of it, but the larger environment that it puts in, because it's going to be like a lens or a filter on the encounter, and helps determine sort of what your resources are, what kind of plans the villain's going to get up to.
So why don't we go through and come up with some examples of different kinds of layers? Let's just run through the process with some examples. Let's just keep going with the dragon.
Right. Okay.
Right? You might as well start there. It's in the fucking name.
It's in the name. It's great. You know, this is one of those styles of play where I don't care that it doesn't make sense that a giant magical lizard has squeezed itself down into these. And maybe it did, right? Like maybe this massive, big as a house green dragon just like over a century just like wormed its way through these tunnels. Its bones slowly reshaping and forming until it got into its lair, and then it's got to like take another couple of centuries to fluff out. Mm-hmm. And you know, that is down it, right? Like, what else is an old dragon gonna do? You can't fly, its wings are atrophied, it's just a big fat dragon. But it can amass treasure, it can scare the little pissant goblins that live in the upper levels.
Yeah, go bring me tribute.
Right, there's something just delightfully weird and implausible about a big creature like a dragon in a tiny, underground and very often very deep sort of place. I feature dragons in dungeons by having, say, like an eyrie or some type of mountaintop where, you know, you enter the dungeon more in the middle and there are levels above you which are riddled with holes and access to it's more like a vertical dungeon. And then the lower levels are more the traditional mega dungeon style, very sprawling, lots of secret, you know, passages and the like. But the upper levels are tall and vertical. It's more about having to navigate the towers. Yeah. Way out of frame up here. Navigate the towers and deal with the fact that there's a dragon that's going to be flying around outside the entire time. So those are some ways to do that. The Underdark, there are dragons that live in the Underdark, right? I think purple dragons, maybe? I don't really know, honestly.
Shadow dragons?
Shadow dragons, gym dragons, some red dragons, Thimbershoed and Out of the Abyss. It's similar to a dungeon, right? How did this big creature get down here? Or maybe what? The dragons are more like worms, right? Like,
yeah,
no wings, just little tiny arms that they use to crawl along the...
Yeah, it's more like a Chinese dragon.
Right, very sinewy. Yeah.
Long and serpentine.
Maybe those dragons just are very different. They're not involved in the politics of the other dragon flights or something. And like I said, urban... you know, the wilderness is more like the classic dragon, right? Most of the dragons in the Monster Manual are wilderness dragons. You find them way out in the middle of nowhere.
Yeah,
you know?
Black dragons in the swamp.
Right.
Green dragons in the forest.
Yeah. You know. If you are a fan of dragons and you want to see how to, like, really put them together and really embed them in the world, then it's worth tracking down Ed Greenwood's Dragons of Faerun series. I think they're archived on several places on the internet. Ed Greenwood has these, like, massively detailed counts and personalities and what their lairs are like and how they interact with their environment. And I think there's probably like 30 or 40-ish, maybe a little less, Dragons of Faerun. It's things like Klauth and some of the others. And then there are those two black dragons that like live in the Mirror of Dead Men, but they're twins, but they never present themselves as twins. They only show up one at a time. And so it's kind of like everyone just thinks it's this super badass, always awake dragon. Like, you were just here. Where did you know? But there's really two of them.
The Christian Balen people from The Prestige.
Yes, exactly.
Got to be dedicated to that shit.
Right. Or the dragon that's in Rise of Tiamat, who has, you know, the white dragon that lives sort of north of 10 towns and has multiple glacier lairs that it keeps its treasure in and has a mate with its wizard rider who died a long time ago, like frozen to its back, that it still keeps back there. So it's like a dead corpse of a thing. It's very bizarre, but really cool.
It's like people who get their pets like stuffed. It's like...
exactly.
Doesn't really look like your pet in right. the pictures, but we just love them.
We just love
like
them.
To have them around. Yeah. It's like, yep. okay.
yep. Mm-hmm. So there's a lot of reasons. You know, the Monster Manual has a ton of inspiration on that. The prior editions have the Draconomicons, both second and third edition mm-hmm. have those. So if you're like super into dragons, this is the game for you, surprisingly. And there's a lot of resources out there. But consider the location that the dragon's in. A young dragon, right? Just barely, just starting out, right? Just out of college.
A young pup.
That internship under their belt. Uh-huh. And now they're just trying to make a name for themselves.
Looking for that first paycheck.
Right. And so their lair might not be as established,
right?
It might be a cave or a ravine deep in the forest. Their treasure might not be as guarded. Their minions might not be as plentiful or as powerful. And so you might see a young dragon more. You might spot it, and therefore, you know, there's more opportunities for the young dragon to perish or to get seriously injured. And again, we're talking like this is world building here. How does that dragon relate to everyone around it? If that's a predator in the region, mm-hmm. what does it prey on? Do those creatures that it prey on care that they are preyed upon?
Yeah.
Questions to ask there are like, what do you do with a good dragon? What do you do if like the cloud above you has an ancient gold dragon that this is its stretch of land, right?
Well, like, you would probably set aside part of your herd in a separate pasture.
Yeah, yeah.
And you just be like, here you go.
Right.
Please, like, please mm-hmm. just stay in this pasture and don't eat these.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah, yeah. Like, mm-hmm. the common land is the dragon's land.
Right, right. Yeah. You know, it protects the village or mm-hmm. whatever mm-hmm. that is below it.
Yeah, maybe it comes down occasionally and resolves disputes or something
Oh, no, that would be awesome. You know, the farmer's mad at so-and-so. You know, he stole some of his cattle.
Yeah.
Now comes Goldie.
Right. If they even know it's the dragon, it could just be like, oh, well, we know that the dragon's elf always comes by. Uh-huh. Right? But it's the dragon.
It's the dragon.
Yeah.
Elf with golden hair and golden eyes. Oh, right.
Particularly if it's like a silver dragon or something like that, or a dragon that lives close to a city, or a dragon that, you know, is not a ravaging bestial monster. But let's say you're just like, you're done with the chromatic metallic. You like a good just Game of Thrones beastie lizard. Right,
yeah.
Just I breathe fire and have a low sort of like animal cunning. Then that's a different lair entirely as well. You know, it will have less in the way of like designed intentional features, mm-hmm. and maybe just be really remote and difficult to get to, and just, you know, maybe there's not a lot there.
Yeah, you know? I mean, it probably wouldn't have minions that would then carve out perfect tunnels to get to it. It would be jagged, you know, tunnels and caverns even to get to its layer, its cavern, which would probably just have a chute that would go straight up.
Right.
Just so it can escape.
Just so it can escape. There are some things to consider, you know, when you're designing a lair, there's tactical considerations, there's naturalistic considerations, there's sort of like, what's the lair for, what's the purpose of it? But you do have to answer some other questions, and we'll get to these with also some of the other examples, is like, there are times where, why in the world would the dragon ever fight someone on the ground? You know, why in the world is it even letting you get to its lair in the first place? Mm-hmm. Is another sort of consideration that you might have. What ways does it have to detect intruders early on so that it can fly out, spend all day just wasting its breath weapon on them, fly back, and then now the group has to, you know, soldier on and get there. And what if it does that every day, that they search this 6-mile hex for where the dragon's lair is?
Yeah.
It makes sorties out to get it. That's how you turn a dragon hunt into a full adventure and not just a 3-round fight that ends up with the dragon disappointingly dead.
Yeah. So when you get to that point, usually that's what happens.
Sure it does, yeah. I think my solution, and this is total tangent, is to just introduce dragons earlier in your campaign. But anyway, well, let's get to the next.
Make people scared of them.
First level.
Volos covers some of these, but it's worth just kind of talking about. But beholders.
The beholder.
Volos has a great section
on
beholder layers.
Yes, it does, yeah.
But some different types of layers. Like mm-hmm. you were explaining to me the other night, one of your... That we never got to.
We never got to.
Thank gods that we never did. Because explain what this encounter would look like.
So I took, you're right, to back up Pruitt and sort of reiterate, Volo's Guide, reread it, Beholders, it's awesome. Perfect. The sample dungeon in there is a great beholder layer for your starting out. And Vast Oblivium from Out of the Abyss is also a really cool beholder layer. We were playing Out of the Abyss, and I had decided that I was going to expand and modify the Vast Oblivium. And I took a medieval cathedral map And if you're familiar with medieval cathedrals, they're generally laid out in a cruciform fashion and tend to have columns and the like. This one was a three level and two rows of columns down the central passage. I forget what it's called, if it's the narthex or the whatever, anyway. And then the wings off to the side are riddled with these pillars and layers and stuff. And so the idea was that I would use this cathedral map and just describe it as a cavernous room that has had the boulders disintegrated out this honeycomb structure on either side that runs around this central shaft. So they can either go in the honeycomb structure and try to deal with the beholder there. They can stay in the central shaft, which is like maybe 90 feet high, and the beholder can just come in and out of the honeycomb whenever it wants, any side, anywhere, up, down, whatever, and have free reign to target the PCs that are in the middle, or they can take their chances and risk getting split up, trying to chase it through this honeycomb, which, you know, they have to fly. Good luck with the anti-magic cone, or they can try to climb. Now it's going to take forever, and mm-hmm. they can just be picked off. So I never got a chance to really put that into play because y'all never went that direction. But I just sort of liked that idea. I don't know what it was. I saw a cathedral map and I was like, that is a beholder lair, mm-hmm. if I have ever seen one.
Yeah.
So when you're designing your beholder lair, like Bolo suggests, and we will harp on, vertical spaces matter.
Yeah.
Vertical spaces matter.
Yes, and beholders can fly. They can fly,
they can hover. They should never be in melee with the party unless something has gone wrong or the party's come up with a really clever plan.
So, yeah.
See, my beholder layer that I want to do is a central vertical shaft with smaller vertical shafts around it.
Uh-huh.
But the main one only really connects to one, and then it's literally just you come in up here and you have to go all the way to the bottom to move over to the next one, all the way up, and so the beholder just kites them. Uh-huh. And in between there are small holes like arrow slits, just big enough for a nice ray mm-hmm. to go through. Yeah. But especially when it moves to from bottom to top, where they have to go all the way to the top, make it a good 100 feet.
Right.
Well within the 100 foot anti-magic.
Right.
But let the beholder sit at the top and wait for them, raining stuff, so if they fly up there, it just turns its eye on them.
Just turns its eye down. Yep.
And then moves to the next one.
Yep.
And just, I mean, I would hate me if I had to
And if it needs to escape, it's just disintegrate ray, I'm out. Right, like mm-hmm. it can't be trapped that way.
You know,
it always has an escape route through it. So yeah, I really like that idea. To me, the beholder is one of those monsters that if, much like the dragon and some others, if you play it the way its intelligence and lore suggests, this should be one of the most frustrating, costly, and we are never doing this again style fights that you would have for your players, because it is a sphere of magical lasers and anti-magic, right, that can perfectly hover and fly and is the nightmare dream of an aberration thing. I mean, it's just absolutely frustrating. I get the tension for a dungeon master, right? The tension is to be like, oh my god, I can have a, you know, in my mind it's something like, I can have a ghost dragon with an anti-magic shell on it. They'll never defeat the dragon. Or I can, you know, think of all these kinds of ways, and maybe that makes sense for the fiction. You've got a beholder with a bunch of magic items on it as well, and a well-stocked minion larder, and a badass sculpted perfect lair, and you realize, like, oh, this is so deadly. This is so just perfect that no player is ever going to walk into this willingly. They're either going to do like Genos and One Punch Man and just like destroy the lair from the outside. Like, it's like, we'll just earthquake.
Well, and that's a viable way to do it if you can cast that.
That is a viable way to do it. Because they'd be fools to try to take on this creature in its lair. And this sort of brings it back to just lairs in general. Like, shouldn't that be the way these monsters are, right?
Home field advantage, right?
Home field advantage. Like, you do not want to tackle this creature in its lair, and it's not going to want to come out of its lair. So what do you need to do? Well, maybe diplomacy is a way to resolve whatever, you know, problem that you've got. You know, that's sort of thinking in lairs in terms of just a location for adventure with mm-hmm. a lot of different ways to tackle the challenge of it.
What about a necromancer? What about what would a necromancer's lair be like? I mean, we could talk about Wizard's Towers, but I think that should probably be a whole show.
I mean, Wizard's Towers should definitely be a whole show. We can kind of,
a necromancer has a certain flavor to it.
Right, yeah. Right. Well, and the necromancer, to me, the chief concern for the necromancer is, do they have a source of bodies. Mm-hmm. And that to me kind of where I would start. There's traditional like cemetery necropolis kind mm-hmm. of thing, and you know, maybe the cemetery, the necromancer's like undercover or on the down low or something.
Yeah.
Maybe they've got a team of grave diggers that go out.
I love the idea of a grave digger that got the body of a wizard who was a necromancer to inter, and he finds a spell book, and that's how he becomes a necromancer.
That's a Warhammer as fuck kind
of. And so it's just like the grave digger. He runs this cemetery. It's got bodies everywhere.
Right. A variant on that is like the necropolis. So sort of think of like the terracotta army. Mm-hmm. You know, it's a necropolis of waiting, willing, undead soldiers. The OSR module, Death Frost Doom, is similar to this, where it's just like sort of a bunch of, you could awaken this horde of creatures. But the lair that I'm thinking of is like an ancient necromancer or like a location that has a lot of ready-to-use, skeletons, zombies, ghouls, ghosts, things like that. And maybe it's one of those societies where necromancy isn't frowned upon. Yeah. And it's like that's the equivalent of their barracks. Yeah. And, you know, but nobody wants to see it, and so it's deep underground or a remote location.
Yeah.
And it requires the necromancer to go there, and the location itself is part of the ritual. When you're there, you harness the necromantic power, allows you to control more undead than maybe you could. Think of it sort of like a necromantic version of Cerebro. Or something that, right?
It's like lays on a ley line of necrotic energy.
Right. Ley lines are a big thing to use in the location of any spellcaster, because you can just say like,
put him on a ley line.
Right. Oh, this wizard has access to meta magic, or this sorcerer has access to spells it might not otherwise have, or this, you know, whatever you need, because you could just you hand wave. It's a ley line. It's a planar confluence. It's mm-hmm.
You can really beef up those layer actions with that.
Yes, absolutely. In this case, the necromancer needs a kind of source of bodies. Well, let's kind of think outside the box. What about a physician?
Dude, a physician.
Doctor's office.
At a hospital. He runs this hospital. Right. You know, the survival rate, it's medieval times. Medicine's not great. There's no cleric in town.
No.
He does his best, but.
Yeah, there you go.
Old Jimmy, he couldn't make it. We'll put him down in the morgue.
Right, well, then you get the nice image of the leather-coated, beaked, plague doctor type image there. And so it's fun, right? Like, you can have that in an urban environment. Maybe the players are out to look for a necromancer. They're going to think to go to the cemetery. It's an obvious location. The misdirect is that it's actually the physician.
Yeah.
Stealing bodies from the town morgue or whatever it is. And so
our morgue gets broken in. People take bodies all the time from the morgue. You want us to investigate? No, we're good.
We're good. So those are sort of some locations. There's also, again, we looking at the locations in the Monster Manual. What does an Underdark necromancer look like? Where are they getting their bodies? Maybe they're animating all sorts of the weird kinds of things that are underneath the ground. One of my favorite things about Veins of the Earth are the fossilized undead. Where sort of like I use necromancy on a fossil, and it's like a two-dimensional undead creature that like lives in the walls and tunnels of the Underdark that can be commanded and the like.
Ooh, that's fun.
Yeah, there's another monster like a vampire that's buried like millennia ago and has just like sunk down into the substrata of the earth and now is a insane fossilized vampire that could be commanded by the undead. Same with like what about an undead underwater, right? A Triton necromancer that's taking like sharks and kraken and the like and animating them, and now the trade fleets up and down the coast can't fish or all this other stuff. What's going on? We don't see anyone.
I caught the skeleton of a fish and then it bit me.
And then it bit me. Yeah. Right, yeah. Like, so there's all those kinds of things. You can build entire plot lines and campaigns and scenarios based on just like a villain and a lair and a location and like the whole thing comes out of it, just those three little pieces.
Yeah.
So,
we've been talking about dragons and beholders and
big bads. Yeah.
But mm-hmm. What about the little guys? What about like just a goblin warren?
Yes.
And again, they cover goblinoids and volos. But
right. Mm-hmm.
What's one way to think about a goblin warren when you want to just like have just a killer fucking lair?
So I think that lairs for non-legendary monsters are number one, you can do them, and number two, they can be really fun. An example of this is like, think of the goblin fight in whatever the first Hobbit movie is. I forget what it is now. Anyway, like they're going to the Goblin
the
King.
Hobbit?
Is it the Hobbit? I thought it had a fancy title or whatever.
Subtitle? Anyway, I don't remember.
Who remembers? It seemed like it was so long ago. You know, like there's the Goblin King and they're sort of like all running around through these tunnels and the whole place kind of collapsing around them. Mm-hmm. That's kind of one, that's sort of like the classic, iconic Goblin Warren. Just these caves that haven't been worked, just natural caverns that have ramshackle construction in them, and they're smoky and dingy and noxious, and there's trash and garbage everywhere, and maybe there's wargs or some other sort of bestial thing that the goblins keep as guard animals or something, and they just they live in trash piles and refuse, and they're just gross little goblins. But that's not all they could be, right? Like you could have goblins that are more urbane, right? Yeah. Like I like a goblin that's as welcome in society as a gnome or a halfling, right? But they're still goblins, right? You know.
Yeah, he's a goblin with manners, but
sure. So like the Goblin Warrens, the a goblin town in the great city of Oracala, Palantine, which is at the easternmost end of the Street of Spells. Goblin Town is a giant sort of hill within the city, and I kind of sort of envision it like the Undercity of Edinburgh or something like. It's a structure that's deliberately subterranean, but has also sort of been built up over time. And it's just riddled and honeycombed, and that's where they have their nurseries and their breeding pits, and that's where they sort of like have all the different schools and workshops and everything like that. And then eventually, you know, it's just a hive of activity, but it's clean. It's sort of an organized chaos. You know, outsiders are kind of welcome in the outer tunnels of it. And it's sort of seen more as just a more of like an ethnic enclave than a warren of gross, shadowy, stabby goblins.
Yeah.
You know, the smells of goblin barbecue and the like wafting up from below. Maybe you remember Demolition Man? I don't remember if you guys ever seen Demolition Man, but it's one of my favorite movies.
And Simon says you should give it a try.
Right. And like the underground when they finally get down underneath it and all the pristine streets of whatever it is, San Angeles or whatever.
I think it's San Diego,
Los Angeles.
Yeah, I think it's San Angeles.
Mm-hmm. And you know, they're cooking rats and
And Dennis Leary's down there stealing Bill Hicks's bit. Yeah. No,
sure.
I get you.
Uh-huh. Yeah. And, you know, that maybe that's what it's kind of like. The upper streets of the Street of Spells, it's the humans and the hobgoblins and the moorbrain, and then underneath it's the rough and tumble rowdy goblin. Mm-hmm. So those are some considerations. But, you know, otherwise you want to think of places that are conducive to a horde of creatures, big open spaces that have lots of levels.
Yeah.
Right? Like the ideal goblin warren has places for them to shoot at intruders, but not necessarily be shot back at, places for them to use their bonus action dash and hide, things like that.
Yeah, you got to have those underground tunnels, little spots to pop up. Mm-hmm. I mean, you got to turn that shit into fantasy fucking Vietnam, right?
Exactly, right, yeah. Yeah,
you should never really see the goblins.
You really should never see the goblins, particularly if you're using like a wilderness goblin, you know, that maybe there's lots of underbrush and tunnels and things like that, and you know, you're always followed by three groups of them, but you only ever see one of them at any given time. The other two are sort of in hiding, things like that. So that's one way that you can turn sort of non-legendary creatures and give them a lair. So in a fight like this, the lair has its own lair actions. There might not be a boss, there might not be a legendary creature that's there, but the lair still gets to go. And like I said, if you have a big horde of them, maybe the lair actions are tied into that being a horde or it's part of the environment or something. Mm-hmm. Maybe they're sort of special things, special effects, or special traps or things like that.
Think about the Ewoks
fight. Right, I mean, exactly,
you know,
right. All of those traps.
You got
traps
logs coming in,
actions.
Log rollers. I mean, you know, do it all.
Yeah, so I mean, that's one thing to kind of think about. It works for both traps. A lair action could be the goblin setting off a trap and targeting with the PCs. Or to kind of backtrack a bit for, say, like a necromancer or a spellcaster, maybe a lair action is setting off a glyph or something like that and having it explode or discharge or whatever it is. So, you know, it's easy to sometimes think of the lair as being always tied to a legendary creature, but it doesn't need to be. And in those cases, the lair is its own thing and can add, you know, sort of an extra layer to your encounters with just sort of minion-type monsters.
Lairs add an extra layer. Jim Davis.
I know.
Love it.
Oh, my God. Profound.
Head on over to Patreon for our weekly podcast and so much more. WebDM is also on Twitch with three weekly games, Starward Bound, Unearthly Twilights, and Land Between Two Rivers, which we upload to WebDM Plays, our second YouTube channel.
Like, you need that.
I love that.
Actually, the thing I am looking out for right now, choice.
Arcane Shadows.
Yeah.
Seen now.
Cool stuff. I love old RPG books.
Oh my god.
Quintessential Samurai.
Wonders of Lankmar.
Was this for probably what, third edition?
Yeah, that's a third edition. Wizards are always in the realm.
Wing Riders of Jagged Cliffs. Ooh.
Yeah.
Land-based casino game. I need to grab that for my game.
It's tier, I know, right?
Ooh, dude. That's fucking awesome. Somebody that might enjoy that. Yeah, okay. I have too many things going on.
Huh?
What? You heard it here first, folks.
What? Which? First,
basic.
He said ever.
What am I looking at?
It's the Mincer rules for fantasy role-playing games. Frank Mincer. Levels 1 through 3. Player's Manual. All right. I'm actually looking for 4th edition stuff, even though I'm over here diving into the game. Oh my god.
It's like I don't even know him anymore.